Hello, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to my talk about the analysis of heatpaths and LED retrofit lamps. Before I start my talk, I like to introduce myself. My name is Peter Nolte, and I'm from the Fraunhofer Application Center for Inorganic Phosphors. There I lead the team Reliability of Phosphors. What do we do in the Fraunhofer Application Center for Inorganic Phosphors? So the Fraunhofer Application Center for Inorganic Phosphors consists of two teams. The first team is called a phosphor design, and it deals with the development of luminescent glasses for next generation LEDs, the combination of phosphors and embedding materials, the optical and structural characterization and testing of phosphors. And then there is a team Reliability of Phosphors, which is led by me. We deal with the heat development in phosphors, thermal management of LEDs and LED modules, and the reliability and long-term stability of LEDs and LED modules. Today we will be talking about the thermal management of LEDs and LED modules. What's the motivation for the work I'm presenting you today? As you all know, the thermal management is one of the main factors for the long-term stability of a luminaire. For a reliable design, an exact knowledge of the thermal path is needed. How to get to this knowledge? So the simplest way to measure the temperature of a PCB or something else is just to attach a thermocouple to the critical components. But there are some issues. If you glue a thermocouple to your device, you change the behavior of your device. Still, a thermocouple is a really small wire, but anyway, you are altering the thermal pathways. Then, it is not very easy to consistently put thermocouples somewhere. So, there might be some differences on exactly the spot where you put the tip of your thermocouple, then it has to be applied with some pressure, so it has to be glued, so then there is somebody has to glue the thermocouple. If you want to take more than one measurement point, you have to attach several thermocouples. So there are many different issues with thermocouples. If you don't like a thermocouple, you will use a thermographic camera. So then you just run your device, and you have a look with a thermographic camera on your device, and this tells you in a thermal equilibrium where there are the hotspots of your device. Now you know where your device is especially warm. What you still don't know is where exactly in the thermal path is the weak point. And therefore, you need some kind of dynamic imaging. That's what we do here. We take a series of thermographic images, and from this series, we are able to fully characterize the heat path in the device we are looking at. Before I talk about our experiments, I'd like to introduce the model we are using. Here we want to describe the heat path in an LED luminaire. Therefore, we have to think about where the heat is generated and which part of the electrical energy which enters the LEDs ends as heat. If we put electrical energy into an LED, the largest part of it will be converted to light. Then there are electrical losses in the PN junction. Additionally, there is a heat generated in the phosphor. This is due to the conversion process in the phosphor, where relatively high energetic blue photons are converted to green and yellow photons with lower energy in order to generate white light. The difference in energy, the so-called Stokes shift, is released as heat. To compensate for this heating, sufficient cooling is needed. Here we assume the heat is fully conducted away from the LED by a strictly one-dimensional heat path with the heat source at its beginning. For the theoretical description of this one-dimensional heat path, we use an electrothermal analogy. Here the heat path is divided into small blocks. Inside these blocks, the heat capacity as well as the thermal resistance are regarded as constant. The thermal parameters are then replaced with their electrical counterparts. This is done to conveniently reuse the theoretical models and concepts which have been developed for the description of electrical circuits. If you look at the circuit on the bottom right, you will recognize it is comprised of a large number of RC circuits. Each of the circuits acts as a low-pass filter, and each of these low-pass filters has a time constant R. This is the timescale it takes to charge or discharge the capacitors. If we now divide the heat path into a large number of segments, we will also get a large number of time constants. These time constants form the time constant spectrum, which fully describes the thermal properties of the heat path. How to get to the time constant spectrum from an experiment? To do this, we first measure the time-dependent thermal impedance, Z, as a response of the system to a step in the heating power. Therefore, we let the luminaires we were investigating run until they reach the thermal equilibrium temperature, T0. After this equilibrium is reached, we switch off the device and measure its cooling curve with a thermographic camera. The difference between the starting temperature and the temperature during cooling is then divided by the step in the heating power. Here we assume this step to be unity for all pixels. As the time scales for the cooling of different parts of the lamps differ by several magnitudes, it is convenient to transient from linear time t to logarithmic time z. In the next step, the derivative of the impedance with respect to z is calculated numerically. If one has a look in the specific literature, one sees that this derivative is the convolution of the time constant spectrum r, which we are looking for, and the function on the right. To calculate the time constant spectrum, we then perform a numerical deconvolution with regard to this function. Here we look at the sample set used in this work. We used a set of 8 commercially available LED retrofit lamps. Note that the lamps A1, A2, as well as the lamps B1, B2, are sold under the same brand and only differ in their CCT. In addition to investigate different lamps, we also investigated the influence of the socket of the lamp. Therefore, we used 2 different sockets, one mainly made of plastics and the other one mainly made of metal. To prepare the samples, we only removed the white dome of the lamps in order to be able to have a direct look at the LED chips. No further modifications were made. To record the thermographic image series, we used the scientific grade thermographic camera with a resolution set to 320 by 256 pixels. Its sampling rate was lowered from 500 Hz at the beginning of the experiments to 1/10 of a Hz at the end of the experiments. This was done with regard to the different timescales in which the cooling happens. Additionally, this saves disk space as well as computational time. Before we look at the dynamics of the cooling, we have a look at the starting temperatures of the different lamps in combination with the 2 different sockets. Here you see a violent plot of the temperature distribution of the thermographic images at the positions of the LEDs. From this graph you can spot several things. The socket does not make a huge difference in the equilibrium temperature of the LEDs. Lamp B2 seems to consist of 2 different sets of LEDs which have different temperatures. Most of the LEDs have a starting temperature of around 100 degrees centigrade, and the LEDs in lamp C and E are significantly cooler. Here you see the average cooling curve of the LEDs in 4 of the lamps in logarithmic timescale. You can recognize the different starting temperatures as shown on the slide before. Additionally, you see several steps of temperature relaxation for each of the lamps. While the lamps share the general position of these steps, they differ in their height and the rotation. To analyze these steps further, we use the time constant spectrum as shown in the next slide. Now we have a look at the time constant spectra of the cooling curves from the slide before. Each of the steps in the cooling curve corresponds to a peak in the time constant spectrum. The area of each peak is proportional to the temperature difference of the corresponding time step. Additionally, the significant building blocks of the lamp can be identified in the time constant spectrum. The maxima at the time constant of 200 milliseconds are assigned to the LEDs, whereas the maxima at the time constant of 10 seconds belongs to the PCB, and the last 2 peaks are related to the lamp socket and housing. Here we had a look at the average time constant spectra of the LEDs in the lamps. This is practical to get an overview of their general behavior. But what if you want to see differences between the LEDs or want to look at different components? Therefore, we comprise the amplitudes of all the time constant spectra of all the pixels into pseudo-color images and created a small movie. Now we have a look at this movie where we go through the different time constants. Let's just watch it. I will talk about the details in a second run. Let's start again. What we see at the beginning of the sequence are the centers of the LEDs. From here, the heat flows to the bottom of the LEDs. and from there to the PCB. At the end of the sequence, the lamp socket cools down. As the sequence is a little bit too fast to look at the details, we took some snapshots at interesting time constants. On the left side of the slide, you see the amplitudes at the time constants as indicated on the right. At the time constant of 13 milliseconds, the center of the LED cools down. Then at the time constant of 132 milliseconds, the LED chip cools down. Later, with a time constant of 9 seconds, the PCB shows up, and at the end, with a time constant of 164 seconds, the lamp socket cools down. Up to now, we only looked at one of the lamps or a small set of the lamps. Now we want to compare all the lamps with each other. As mentioned earlier, the area under each peak is proportional to its corresponding temperature step. So we fitted each of the peaks in the time constant spectra of the pixels at the positions of the LEDs with Gaussians, and plotted their areas against the positions of their centers. Here we look at the plot of the peak areas against their center positions, in the log-log plot. As you can see, the points separate into 5 clusters. From this it can be concluded that all of the lamps share a common design principle. But still these clusters have a considerable size. As an example, we compare lamp A2 and AB. As can be seen, the points of peak 1 are very close together. For peak 2, the points of the two lamps separate for the time constants as well as for the peak areas. Peak 3 shows a large variance for lamp A2. What has to be noted is that peak 4 and peak 5 merge for lamp A2. To sum up these findings, it can be concluded that the lamp A2 has a better LED cooling. Let's conclude my talk. I presented a method which allows to calculate the time constant spectrum for each pixel of a thermographic image sequence. This method was used to analyze and compare different LED retrofit lamps, where we looked at the cooling performance of different parts. At the end, I'd like to thank you for your time and hope to see you in person again next year in Bregenz.